Thank you, Chairperson Angela. I think you are going to make my work a little easier, because you have been familiar with this process since 2014. Some of the slides I'm going to present, some of you have been participating in our JSR processes, have seen them before, but we never try to repeat the message, to especially to the people that have not been part of this process, because we want to make sure that as many people on the continent as possible understand this mutual accountability support mechanism. So basically, the call for accountability on the continent is not something new. As far back as 2003, when African heads of state and government met in Maputo, this was one of the 7 principles to establish mechanisms for peer review, dialogue, supporting mutual accountability at country and regional level, to ensure that whoever is part of the CADAP process is accountable for the actions and promises that they make. Moving forward to 2014, after 10 years of CADAP implementation, again when the heads of state and government met in Malabo, they recommitted themselves to the principles they had adopted in Maputo. And in the Malabo Declaration, there are 7 commitments. And commitment number 7 is about strengthening mutual accountability. And the heads of state called specifically for a biennial review. In other words, having a review of CADAP implementation every 2 years, producing a report that AUC and NPC have to present to them every 2 years. So the first such a report is going to be presented in January of 2018. So already African Union and NPCA are putting in place mechanisms to prepare themselves to, through a process of presenting that, preparing that report and presenting it. So the point I'm making here is that what I'm sharing with you is not new, and it is a continuous process to support mutual accountability at country and regional level. And mutual accountability, basically, as it says, the word mutual and then accountability, it's about different parties agreeing to hold each other accountable to actions that are either in a CADAP compact, or the National Agriculture Investment Plan, or any other cooperation agreement that the parties agree to. Now, there are principles which guide mutual accountability. And I want to relate these principles to what is taking place with the call by the African leaders in the Malabo Declaration. So first of all, there has to be a shared vision. So it doesn't matter whether it is a CADAP compact, a national investment plan, or a cooperation agreement, the parties that are agreeing have to have a common vision on what they aim to achieve. And in this case, the Malabo Declaration contains the goals and aspirations of the continent as far as agriculture development is concerned. So the Malabo Declaration is the shared goal. They need to have common objectives, and what is taking place at country and regional level is the development of national agriculture investment plans, which provide the details of what is going to take place towards achieving the visions and targets within the Malabo Declaration, as well as other cooperation agreements, for example, New Alliance, Grow Africa, and so on. The other principle is about agreeing on how to track progress. And that means having a common set of agreed indicators that will be tracked and reported on with regard to progress. And in this case, for the Malabo Declaration, there is a revised CADAP results framework that has about 40 indicators that will be reported and that will be tracked and reported on over the next 10 years. The fourth principle is about having open and genuine dialogue by all the parties. Open, frank, inclusive dialogue to talk about the progress made, the challenges faced and discussing what needs to take place, developing action plans for implementation to improve the quality of implementation and therefore increase the chances of getting better results. Now, the Aquaculture Gene Sector Review is a way, like Angela was saying, to operationalize the beach accountability, especially the Aquaculture Gene Sector Reviews at country level and also at regional level. And it's about basically, you know, assessing the performance of the aquaculture sector, looking at the results that were hoped to be achieved by the country or through the cooperation agreement. And the results ought to assist countries or regions to either continue with the same priorities they set before, especially if performance was good, or perhaps change course if the results are not good. So in other words, the joint sector review process can also be used as a management tool for program management. But also, it allows different people, different stakeholders, from government, from the private sector, from civil society, from academia, to come together and look at the commitments that all made in the CADAP compacts or national investment plans or regional aquaculture investment plans as well. In the first quarter of 2013, when the African Union and NPCA initiated this process, the first thing was to have a technical meetings of people, of technical agencies led by IFPRI Research, the supporting NPCA, AUC. We called in member states from the different parts of the continent to put together a technical document that would guide the joint sector review process. So we developed a concept note that described what a GSR should be, a robust GSR should look like, what it should assess, how it would be conducted at country level, and so on. So five key areas are typically assessed in a GSR. The first one is about the high-level outcomes that are either in the national, in the CADAP compact or in the national crisis investment plan. So the high-level aspirations, poverty reduction, food and nutrition security, job creation, increasing incomes, and so on. And in the context of Malabo, this is again what is contained in the first level of the CADAP, of the revised CADAP result framework, those high-level indicators. The second area is about the performance of the aquaculture sector itself. So the outcomes, the outputs for investments that are made in the aquaculture sector. Again, when you look at the CADAP results framework, those five areas in level two of the CADAP results framework is what would be assessed under the performance of the aquaculture sector. The GSR also assesses financial and non-financial commitments, both by government, private sector, and so on. Assesses policies and institutions, how they work, how strong they are, supporting the implementation of the investment plan or the CADAP compact, and also assessing multi-sectoral linkages, because as you know, the aquaculture sector to perform and get the desired results is not the function of just the Ministry of Agriculture. It has to be other institutions, other government agencies as well. Now, when you look at the bullet 2, 3, 4, and 5, these are related to level 3 of the CADAP results framework. And that level of the results framework is basically about having investment that create systemic capacity support the aquaculture sector to perform the way it should. So level one of the results framework is about outcomes, level two is about outputs from the aquaculture sector, and level three is about the support mechanisms that have to be there to support, to create the environment for aquaculture to take place. Now, what takes place at country level in this GSR assessment? I should mention that, again, aquaculture reviews are not new. They haven't been invented today. Different countries have been undertaking reviews, but they vary from one country to the other, both in terms of content and also who participates in them. And in many countries, they tend to focus on one aspect of the aquaculture sector. And in many countries, we have seen them focusing on just aquaculture public expenditure reviews. And those are conducted between governments and donors without participation of others. So the GSR assessment exercise, what it does is to say, to assess what is the current practice in the country, how it has been conducting the review against a set of best practices that guide a robust aquaculture joint sector review. And so when a country goes through that process, assessing what they currently do against the best practices, they are able to identify where the gaps are that they need to work on to strengthen that process at country level. So that's why we call it a GSR assessment. The first contact we have with the countries is about a GSR assessment. Once that is done, the country then develops an action plan on how they are going to tackle those areas that are weak in their in the way they have been conducting the reviews. And then the expectation is that subsequent GSRs will be more robust because they will have identified areas within the processes and they can work on them to improve them. But typically, what takes place is these GSRs are led by ministries of agriculture, and they start by setting up a steering committee, which is chaired by permanent secretary or director of planning. But the leadership is typically by ministries of agriculture. And for that process to take place every year, they have to have a small secretariat within the ministry that is charged with leading that process. They are responsible for developing terms of reference, the questions that have to be answered for that review. And there is room for those questions to vary depending on the policy questions that the country is grappling with. Mobilizing resources, you need to have maybe a consultant hired that support the process. You will need financial resources from domestic resources or from development partners. Constituting a review team that is going to lead the process, actually undertaking the review, holding a national workshop to validate the report, either of the national team or the consultant who produced it. And that dialogue has to be inclusive. All stakeholders have to be on board for it to be a credible review. And then arising out of that, like I said, to have an action plan that is going to be implemented to improve the quality of the process. How is it initiated? Like we said, reviews have been taking place. AUC and PCA leadership realized that they need to be stronger, hence the GSR assessments. But what triggers that to take place at the country level? Basically, the process begins with a letter from the African Union Commission writing to the Minister of Agriculture to initiate the process. And the steps that I just described, then that's what follows once a letter has come from the African Union Commission. RISACS has been requested to provide technical support to African Union and the NEPAD agency in this exercise. And as you know, RISACS is present on the continent in three regions. For Eastern Central Africa, based at ILRI in Nairobi, Southern Africa at International Water Management in Pretoria, and for West Africa at IITA. So we have teams in all these regions that support the respective member states with the GSR assessment exercises upon the request of the African Union and the NEPAD agency. So with our support to the countries, reports that are produced at country level have to go through the dialogue process that I described, to make sure that the stakeholders are in line and supportive of the process right from the start. And in order to improve participation, we have partnered with the CADAP Non-State Actors Coalition, because one of the weaknesses that was observed was the limited participation of civil society. And so the civil society organization have got themselves organized and created the CADAP Non-State Actors Coalition, and they have become very strong partners with RISACs in supporting these JSR assessments and also the actual JSRs that countries are conducting. On the partners that undertake these reviews, like I said, AUC is provide the, and NPCA provide the political leadership of this process at the regional level. Regional economic communities are part of the process. Of course, national governments, then CADAP Non-State Actors Coalition that I just talked about, development partners. We have also partnership with Africa Lead, which helps us especially with mobilizing stakeholders at country level, supporting validation workshops, hiring facilitators, and so on. And obviously, IFPRI and RISACs providing the technical support to this process. Okay, so we started in 2014, and what progress have we made? 2014, we supported 7 countries with JSR assessments, and they all developed action plans, which they have been implementing since then. So the 7 countries are listed up there. We learned lessons, given that initial exercise. So in 2014, we said, okay, we can scale up the exercise, and we are covering 11 countries, 3 of which are complete. So we are done with DRC, Swaziland, and Uganda, and the processes are ongoing in the other 8 countries. So we hope by the end of this year, we'll have the 11 countries covered, and that will bring a total of 18 countries by the end of this year. Once we have done the assessment, we don't leave the countries alone. We remain ready to support the countries with the implementation of the action plans that they develop out of the JSR assessments. And we are expanding also our support to the regional economic communities, working with the first REC, ECOWAS. It is the first REC to want to conduct the regional JSR. And I think they are going toward the JSR workshop, I think in November, if I'm not mistaken, November this year. And the lessons that are learned from the regional exercise, I think, will also be helpful for the other RECs once they decide to go ahead with the processes themselves. Moving forward, we are going to, tomorrow we have the RISACs annual planning meeting based on the feedback we shall get from the parallel sessions in the different regions later this morning. We'll decide how many countries that we can expand to in 2016. Again, as you've heard, there is going to be the biennial review taking place in 2016-2017, the biennial review will take place January of 2018, but the preparations for that will have to be taking place in 2017 and March of 2016. So our support to AUC and NPCA on this JSR is going to be also informed by the needs for that process. So our meeting tomorrow will be, we'll think about, how do we scale up the JSR assessments so that by the time we are into middle of 2016, early 2017, we have a critical mass of countries that have gone through this JSR assessment and are ready to use that exercise to produce their JSR reports that will be used in the compilation of the continental report. So that discussion we'll have tomorrow, but will be informed by the discussions in the parallel sessions later on. So we are going to expand, scale up, but also ensuring that this is directly linked to the CADAP biennial process and eventually the production of the report. My last slide, Chairperson, is sharing some lessons or reflections on what we are learning. The first important thing is leadership at continental level that is provided by African Union and NEPAD is very important. We are technical people. We provide technical support, but the leadership, the political leadership that AUC and NPCA provide is very important. It softens the work for technical agencies that we provide. At country level, the political leadership at ministry level, so the permanent secretary or the minister to appreciate that the GSR assessment is a tool that is there to help them in their own accountability mechanisms to improve accountability at country level is very, very important. So the enthusiasm that is expressed and shown and the support that we receive from them makes our work much easier. So it's very important to have that leadership at country level. Like I said, one of the principles of mutual accountability is inclusive participation, but that is not something that takes place obviously, and you cannot take it for granted. It is something that has to be constantly worked upon. And like I said, the partnership that we have created with the CADAP Non-State Actors Coalition, they actually do help mobilize the non-state actors in the member states to participate in the GSR process. So we don't take it for granted. It has to be something that is actually constantly worked upon, and we are building on that partnership. I should have mentioned that we are RISAX and the CADAP Non-State Actors Coalition this year signed an MOU that is going to guide our activities in supporting CADAP implementation over the next 10 years. The other observation that we can make is the action plans. Like I said, one of the outputs from the GSR assessment is an action plan developed by the country itself on how they intend to improve the GSR process in their country. But follow up of that also, we are learning needs to be further supported. And so that's why in our work plan we reserve time to support those countries that went through the GSR assessment but still need to be supported to actually implement the action plan. And RISAC stands ready to work with NPCA UC to make sure that the action plans are implemented. The last observation is that the different, because countries implement different programs which are initiated at different times and they have different review mechanisms and so on. And so the GSR process basically calls for increasingly countries to have just one review mechanism. And that mechanism, we believe, should be the joint sector review process. As long as an initiative is supporting aquaculture development in a country and is subject to annual review and reporting, we believe rather than have a multiplicity of reporting mechanisms, effort should be made to move towards one uniform review process, and that is the aquaculture joint sector review. Chairperson, I stop there. Thank you very much.